Alright guys, Tatakura back again today. I hope you're all doing well and enjoying your day so far. The Rostermania chaos certainly does continue. Rumours coming out last night that Damon Carmobalo, the first ever three-time world champion, could have returned to the CDL last season on the Subliners, potentially some other teams as well. And we're going to talk about Rostermania predictions all across the board. Very much intrigued to your thoughts in the comment section below. Like if you guys enjoyed the video, subscribe if you're new as always, I greatly appreciate it. Really up to the channel, thank you very much indeed for doing that. First of all, just wanted to mention this from United because there has been some discussion as of late. In terms of, what expansion could potentially happen this season, next season, is Cloud9 coming into play? United would be another organisation we would like to see back if they have the funding to do so. But I just don't know if it's going to happen quite as of yet. So it seems like they're entering a new title, but probably not going to be Call of Duty, I would imagine. Also has been a fair bit of talk about Vanguard as of late, as Brian Saint says, the coach of the Minnesota Rocker, really hoping we get squad spawns again next year. Wasn't the pro's favourite thing, let's just say, about Modern Warfare, that when one player spawns up, the rest of the squad tends to just spawn straight on top of them, whereas maybe you get some sort of split spawns or situations like that, which might make more sense in a realistic hardpoint game mode. But Modern Warfare didn't decide to go down that route, especially in 5v5. It created a lot of chaos. So who knows what the logic is going to be. To be fair to Sledgehammer, they did a great job last time around. I think that some people are somewhat concerned, and maybe rightfully so, at least for the competitive side, that we're going to get a game this year in Vanguard, which is probably going to be relatively similar to Modern Warfare 2019, just because that game was very well loved by the more casual scene, and also it's got to integrate with Warzone, and then just a year after Sledgehammer's title in Vanguard, we're probably going to get the sequel to Modern Warfare 2019 or whatever that's going to be from Infinity Ward, which maybe won't be the most competitively focused game, but I guess that does remain to be seen. We can hope that Activision have more synergies with how they're structuring their competitive scene going forwards, but maybe squad spawns, we can leave that in the dust with any luck going forwards. This happened on this day yesterday, several years ago, 7 years ago now. Wow. James Crowder, that being replays, replays at the time now. Crowder, of course, the coach of the Atlanta FaZe team, Jeremy Stard and Zuma, their first event victory alongside Sentu, is Heglitch in the check right here. But yeah, $10,000. I know that a couple of you guys are mentioning the fact that, I was looking at the rankings in terms of, player earnings throughout their entire careers. And of course, Simpar, Season, Abizi are right up there right now. But to be fair to some of the top guys, they, they competed in eras like this, where they were earning much less, prize money per tournament. So, but also you can say that the competition back then was somewhat less as well. So it's kind of a give and take, but certainly some players have been around for a very long time and have accomplished great things. I mean, this is just a legendary year in dry tier. So this also was interesting because Blast, who was a pro player during the World War II season, not the worst player in the world, but didn't exactly, he wasn't spectacular, let's just say. He's been playing Warzone as of late, making a fair bit of money over there. Joined Minnesota Rocker as kind of a streamer. Challengers in Vanguard sounds pretty fun, he says. Who knows? Maybe we get some sort of former pros that like to rate it on already though. Like, he's definitely been talking lately about, yes, he enjoys playing competitive Warzone. It's good fun and it's easier money than it was in competitive Call of Duty, but the competitive itch in him is still raring to go. And maybe if it's fun, some players could hop into challenges, kind of as we saw with Damon Carmobalo right at the start of the season, right? There were some Challenger Cups going on, and Carmo was considered one of the best players in these early Challenger Cups with a sniper in hand. He was disgusting. And apparently around about that time, kind of at the start of the season, when Zuma was stepping out with his injury, actually he got an offer from the New York Subliners to potentially join their team.
Damon had offers from teams this year to play, and he could have taken them.
Yeah, I was about to say that. That's kind of interesting.
Damon had offers from New York. I'll just go out and say it.
Oh,
Damon literally got offered.
No, he really doesn't give up.
Damon got offered from New York in the middle of the year when they were. I think it was when Tommy quit. I want to say.
So what might this potentially have looked like, right? Because at the start of the season, we had Zuma there, we had Mac around there, we had the whole Asim Hydra question mark. Hydra was on the bench initially. Diamond Con was into that team as well, of course, when Zuma stepped out. So it was kind of chaotic right at the start of the season. So Karma, the first of a three-time world champion, could potentially have joined this squad if he wanted to. And Holly, that's his wife, comes in the reply, I'd love to see him compete again. I think a lot of people would have, hearing about this, would have loved to hear it, to see him come back. He retired in around about May of last season during the Modern Warfare season on Seattle Surge, and understandably so, right? The pains of online Call of Duty, the difficulty in getting on every day and grinding and practicing, not necessarily something he wants to be doing anymore. Does he necessarily have the motivation to, become a pro player again? It's tough to say, but there has been some talk about it, right? Like maybe Optic go down the route of getting Karma back if he wants to. I'm just not sure that's where he sees himself in his career right now, but he does go on to confirm this was indeed the case. So, Slack's thing he's saying, Cap, but as Karma says in reply, not offer, so not specifically an offer to join join one of these teams, but a lot of players asked him like if he actually wanted to join, and he actually says here multiple teams, not just the New York Subliners, but other teams wanted Karma on their starting team, maybe after the performances he was putting up in some of the early Challengers Cups, but not something he clearly wanted to do. If he hadn't done though, like, what could the scene have looked like today if Karma actually made his return as a pro player? Because he kind of made a return once during World War II when he got benched after CWL Seattle or something, and didn't play the rest of the season, didn't even go to the World War II World Championship because he was stuck on the sidelines over at Optic Gaming, and they kind of dropped him effectively off that team after the dynasty collapsed. But then we get the start of Black Ops 4, he comes back into the team for 5v5 and wins the very first event, and Scump effectively says in an interview afterwards, like, you know, he never should have got rid of him and this type of stuff, but came back to great effect as soon as he returned to the scene, and maybe he could do that again, who knows. Clearly the talent is there, but whether the drive and the motivation is there anymore, that is probably something that is lacking. Obviously he turned down these offers for a reason, but maybe teams will start banging his line again if he starts popping off in some of these early cups. So wanted to mention this. So Looney and Co were going through yesterday and running through what their Rostermania predictions are for the season. I think there could be a few more European talents down here in the free agent pool, but it is what it is, I suppose. They've got some of the guys over at the London Royal Ravens in terms of how they're building these rosters. So I think these are kind of interesting. We can run through them, and I'm definitely intrigued to hear your thoughts down below what teams you think might well occur, because FaZe are going to stick. They've actually got Optic sticking, which I wouldn't exactly expect right now, but it isn't out of the realms of possibility. Then Dallas Empire. So this is one that I actually think is pretty damn likely. Though, of course, we know that Clayster and Crimson, they probably want to team up again. I wouldn't be surprised. It was talked about in the middle of the season that they were trying to get Clayster into that team, but it didn't work out, and that's why they were trying to hit Illy on the SMG while they were trying to get Clay. But then Yule got very good, and then he actually stayed over there. But Crim and Clay, legendary duo, it'd make a lot of sense, I think, for those two to come back together. Clay is the main AR, Crimson is kind of that flex, because Crim is a really aggressive main assault rifle, as he was in this current team. He's probably better suited to a very aggro AR role and have someone actually post up behind it, because he does go rogue quite often, and maybe you need somebody who's going to be a little bit more stonewall in how they're locking down the rotations. And then, of course, Shotzi, that's a no-brainer. The fourth is an interesting one, because if Illy's going to be on the SMG, that's I'm not sure Illy Shotzi as an SMG duo is necessarily going to work. If it were me, I might think about having Vivid and just like keep him on the bench and maybe try Illy and Shotzi at the start as the SMG duo, and if it doesn't work out, then bring in Vivid from the bench, because Shotzi and Vivid definitely also a very solid SMG duo as well. So I wouldn't be surprised to see Dallas do something like this. We've got Los Angeles Grillers. I mean, we've got some crazy teams being formed right here. Gunners, TJ, Methods, and Nero. So this is effectively the Rise Nation team for the World War II days, but minus Looney, of course, who's over here, plus Nero, who is on their academy team at the present time. Then we've got Thieves, we've got Kenny, Octane, Vivid, and Draz. So that'd be interesting to see Vivid go there. That might make a decent amount of sense, to be fair, and then they've put Hook over at the Florida Mutineers, actually keeping Skies and Awakening plus Hook plus Neptune. So I don't know if this is incredibly likely, but it could well happen that only the three of those guys remain. But if I was Florida, I'd probably want to make a two-man change and send Awakening somewhere else. I like the London team of Afro, Zero, Nasty, and Harry or Gizmo. I think that could be fantastic. I think Zero's got to be a no-brainer. Plus Afro, already you've got a scary team, and the rest of these guys are very talented also. We've got Major Maniac and Co sticking over here at the Minnesota Rocker, which I think it is pretty expected as well. But then the Subliners is where things get very spicy indeed. We've got some interesting teams here as well. They've got Toronto sticking. I think there's a great chance that more of these teams change, right? Like, they've got FaZe, Chicago, Rocker, and Ultra sticking. I think the four teams sticking is probably too much. Like, maximum of three are going to stick, in my opinion, at least. So I think that one of these is going to do at least something here. Subliners, it gets kind of spicy because we've got the Scene, we've got Hydra still, and then we've got Slasher and Sib. Like, this could be really cool. At the same time, like, if that team, it doesn't just explode with Slasher and Sib on there, like, I don't know what to say anymore. Like, I would be very surprised if that team doesn't completely implode in terms of chemistry-wise. But yeah, maybe it could happen, I don't know. Seattle Surge, they've got a very interesting lineup, given the fact that I suppose that Phoenix is over there as the coach, and maybe Paul X Venom, Gravity could be considered. They've even chucked Mac on this team as well, and Pritt, I think, definitely a talent, as maybe has been a discussion with Seattle Surge down there from the APAC region. And then Paris Legion, they're trying to put together a score where maybe 10 accuracy, even royalty, and figure something out over there. Pristini also someone to be considered most certainly. So it's a really interesting time. It's very tough to predict. But I think that maybe we're going to get more changes than what we see right here, which is already quite a few, no doubt. This from Holly, I did think it was kind of funny, actually, as well. You know, I'll be sleeping on the couch for at least a month as she comes up to Karma right here with a frog. I don't even know where she managed to find a frog from, but I chucked it on the shoulder, and Karma isn't the happiest man in the world. His face just cracks me up right here. And yeah, like, he jumps off him and Karma gets kind of scared. But you know, it is what it is. Holly just having a good time. And David Carmavano, this man's the three-time, and maybe he's going to make the return next season. I don't really know. It could have happened this season, apparently, no doubt. And just to finish off with this, I thought it was actually very interesting from COD Complex. S&D, K, KDs when last alive. So it seems like the average KD is just under a 0.7 when you're last alive. So generally, you're last alive in a 1 versus 4, 1 versus 2, 1 versus 3, whatever. Like, you're going to get pinched in and probably going to die without getting a kill a lot of the time. And so the CDL average is actually very low. The best player in these types of situations is Diamond Con, apparently a 1.12 KD. The only player above a 1 in these types of situations. Priest is up here, Stanley's up here, you know, the kind of top 5. Scump here at 5 as well. And well, it puts into a lot of these situations, 99 situations where he's last alive. That's kind of tough, and it's kind of funny comparison really to Abizi, who that barely ever happens to, because well, he's in first bloods all the time, so they either win the round outright or he is dead long before seeing the end of the round. But very much intrigued to get your thoughts on all this stuff in the comment section below. Hope you guys enjoyed the video. If you did enjoy it, I'd greatly appreciate a like on the video. It really helps out the YouTube algorithm. I know you enjoyed this content, other people like you may enjoy this content as well, and upgrade the competitive quality community. Thank you much as always, take care, and I will see you next time.